My name is Pastor Ed McKinney, and welcome to Fairview Beyond Methodist Church. We're glad that all of you are here as we worship God together. I'd like to call to your attention a few announcements. Note that on Tuesday, the 22nd, the Joy Club will meet at 11:30 for our annual church picnic. You'll note that Harry Fritz is at Myrtle Beach Manor, and he has received a few cards from you, and if you'd like to send him some more, he'll be more than happy to receive them. Note also that the Beacon newsletter will be coming out next Sunday, so if you have any articles or contributions, please have them to Sarah McKinney, August 22nd. You can email them or call her, and she will get all that together.
David?
Yes.
You said, I might have misunderstood you, but I thought you said that annual picnic is Tuesday. It is Joy Club.
Yeah, that's it. That's what I said.
I thought you said annual picnic.
It's Joy Club picnic. We have never, ever run out of food. It is Joy Club's annual picnic. Okay. You'll notice in our spiritualistics when we make note of the attendance and giving of the church that there's a little bit of a change. The Joyful Giving Group has given us a tool to show in a graph how we're doing financially, and we're doing really well. You'll see that our budget year to date is $87,528. That is our weekly budgeted need, which is $28,2350 times 31, which is we're 31 Sundays through the year, and we received $94,277. So we're ahead of budget.
Yay!
Also, you see that we are just $4,000 short from meeting our goal to pay for all the renovations at the parsonage. That is an extraordinary feat. And if you want to make that balance zero, I invite you to make a special contribution to that. But note also that our first funding priority is the general budget. And the general budget is the first funding in our first priority in our ministry, and it's the way that we do all the wonderful things. So I invite you to give accordingly, either through our offering or through the electronic giving that we offer. If the ushers will please come forward, we will receive the offering. God of blessing, your mercy knows no bounds. You have expanded your everlasting covenant with your people Israel to include people of every nation, to all whom you love. We were like dogs who were glad for the crumbs under the table, who now delight in feasting as sons and daughters of Christ. Send your Spirit to guide us to bring all you call to rejoice in the midst of your congregation. We dedicate these tithes and offering in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
as we come together offering our prayers and concerns to God. I'd like to, for us to remember the Peggy Stewart family. She was tragically killed at work this week in Thomasville, a victim of domestic violence in our hometown. Pray for peace here. Also, we pray for our world and our nation as we deal with strife among people of difference and with different opinions and different philosophies of life. We pray that peace may reign upon all the earth. Also, we give thanks that Larry and Donnie are here with us today, and we pray that God's blessing will be with them. Welcome. We're glad that you're here today. Also, I have a couple of notes of thanks. This is from Bailey Plummer. The front says, "No act of kindness, no matter how small, is ever wasted," from Esau. It says, "Thank you, dear church family. Thank you for all the items in the college care basket. They will all be very beneficial again. Beneficial at school. Thank you again. Love, Bailey." And then Miss Carolina. "Thank you, Carter. With the library out front and Ramsey the Ram right there." By the way, yesterday I met Billy Carter, who played for the Tar Heels from 1977 to 1981. Saw him at the golf tournament yesterday. Very nice guy. Dear church family, thank you so much for the assortment of supplies and gifts for school. It's nice to use an item and remember that someone from home loved you enough to give it to you. No matter how far away from home we go, we know that this is, church is always sending their love and support. Thanks so much for all that you do and continue to do. In Christ, Cindy Palmer." Are there any other joys or concerns? Let us now go to the Lord in prayer. And as we sing, "Blessed be the tide of eyes." Oh, no, that's not quite. Sorry. "What a friend we have in Jesus," verses 1 and 2. You have blessed us with such variety in this gathering. You have not demanded that everyone be the same, have the same degree of faith, or offer the same service. You have freely given healing to each of us today. Lord, forgive us for when we sometimes think that we should be the only ones who receive these blessings, and we turn our back on those in need, either by refusing to help or by pretending that the needs do not exist. But you have heard the cries of all who are in need, and you turn to each one with your healing love. Forgive our selfishness and stubbornness. Heal us and turn us again toward pathways of compassion for all your people. Today we have offered many names in prayer for healing, restoration, hope, and peace. Today, we have spoken names aloud in this gathering, while others remain in our hearts and our minds. Yet you have heard each cry for healing. You have heard all the prayers we have offered. You've heard our prayers for individuals in our community, our nation, and our world. Now let us place our trust in your compassion. Let us remember that your blessings extend to all people. Strengthen us in this time to be witnesses to your love and servants in all ministry to all your people. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, hallowed be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Praise his God for sin.
children come forward, and some of them are going to go gather our food for Pastor's Pantry. Let us stand and for us remain seated and sing Jesus Loves the Little Children.
Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world.
Good job. Good job, huh? Can you hear me? Better? No? No. No, because I turned it on. Yeah, I turned it off. Any better?
No.
No? I'll just be loud.
I have such a quiet voice anyway. We're going to have group participation, so this will be good anyway. The first I'm going to read from Matthew. 15th chapter, 26th and 27th verse. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me, she said. He replied, it is not right to take the children's bread and toss it to their dogs. Yes, Lord, she said, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. So we're going to have, like I said, group participation. We often join in too. The first ones may not be as important to you as the other. So, Batman or Superman? Batman? Raise your hand. Superman? All right. This will be more for y'all. Cinderella or Snow White? Cinderella?
That's a hard
choice. Okay. I bet I know what you're going to say for this one. Ariel or Belle? Ariel?
Ariel. Matter if you're a Carolina or a Duke, we can all still come here together and be friends.
be part of the family of God. So I'm going to have a blessing, and I'm also going to bless the food. Close your eyes. Heavenly Father, particularly in this time, it is good to remember the story that we can disagree, but we can disagree in love and have thoughtful conversations and still care and love for each other. And just like the woman in the story, she continued to yell and ask why until she got your attention and you were able to heal her daughter. Please let us remember that as we go out this week. Also, please take this food, bless it, multiply it so someone else can feel your love. Bless these children and keep them safe until we're all back together. Amen. Thank you.
Our scripture lesson today is from Matthew chapter 15, beginning with verse 10. I will read the first half, Bridget will read the second half. Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it what comes out of the mouth that defiles." When the disciples approached and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said?" Jesus answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one person guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then Jesus said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, and slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile."
Then Jesus left Galilee and went forth to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Gentile woman who lived there came to the Lord, pleading, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David, for my daughter is possessed by a demon that torments her severely." But Jesus gave her no reply, not even a word. Then his disciples urged him and to send her away. Tell her to go away, they said. She is bothering with us with all her begging." Then Jesus said to the woman, It was sent only to help God's lost sheep, the people of Israel. But she came and worshipped him, pleading again, "Lord, help me." Jesus responded, It isn't right to take food from the children and throw it at the dogs," she replied. "That's true, Lord. But even dogs are allowed to eat the scraps that fall beneath their master's table." "Dear woman," Jesus said to her, "your faith is great. Your request is granted." And her daughter was instantly healed. For the word of God, for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
this week, the countries of India and Pakistan celebrated an anniversary of sorts. 70 years ago this week, India and Pakistan declared independence from each other. On August 14th and 15th, 1947, millions of Hindus migrated from modern-day Pakistan and millions of Muslims migrated from India to form two separate independent states divided on religious grounds. Pakistan became an independent Muslim nation and India became an independent Hindu nation. In all, 10 million people were displaced and 1.8 million people died. Historically, Muslims and Hindus never got along. When the oppressive regime of the British Empire pulled out of the region, their newfound freedom gave them liberty to hate each other once again. Ever since 1947, Hindu India and Islamic Pakistan have been bitter rivals. The rivalry has fueled an arms race where each nation have about 130 nuclear missiles pointed at each other. In the sport of cricket, the 2015 World Championship between India and Pakistan was played in Australia. The tickets sold out in 10 minutes, and 288 million people watched the game in both countries. In comparison, only 177 million people watched last year's Super Bowl. In present-day Pakistan, the prevailing culture emphasizes how the Muslims of Pakistan were victims of the Hindus from India, and it trickles down to very young generations. A reporter, whose name is Dia Hadid, was speaking to an oral historian who was working on a goodwill project by having Pakistani and Indian children send postcards to each other. She had two big obstacles. First, quite a few schools rejected her because they didn't want their children speaking to the children of India. Second, whenever she did finally make it to a classroom, some of the kids just refused to write postcards because they hated the people of India so much. These are children who never met an Indian child, someone from the other side. The partition between India and Pakistan only happened 70 years ago. So there are people who remember the migration. And those who experienced a terrifying flight from their homes in India into Pakistan. But their voices and their stories have been silenced. Many people who survived the horrors of partition survived because they were helped by people who were meant to be their enemies. Hindus helped Muslims and Muslims helped Hindus. People took unbelievable personal risks to help each other, but those stories have been lost, silenced, or forgotten. I explain this scenario to you because it illustrates our human condition. Regardless of where we come from, what our religion is, what our culture is, what the color of our skin is, we are suspicious of people who are different from us. So much so that if we hear any stories that contradict our suspicions of other people, we are quick to disregard them as isolated incidents, silence them, or destroy them. It is indeed sad that Pakistani children have not heard the stories of how their grandparents survived their migration due to the help of their Hindu neighbors. However, prejudice and hate are not limited to the Indian subcontinent, and they are not limited to the United States, and they're not certainly limited to the first century Palestine where Jesus lived. What we learn from today's lesson is that prejudice is a part of every culture, and it's so pervasive and invisible that Jesus struggled with prejudice when he encounters the faith of the Canaanite woman. Jesus was born and raised in first century Jewish culture. Some things about Jewish culture are great. They have great food, great music, and great traditions. Their religious texts form the foundation of our religious text. They are the Old Testament. However, growing up in a strictly Jewish culture does have its drawbacks. Jews are suspicious of non-Jews, especially Canaanites. In Genesis chapter 12, when Abraham left his homeland, Ur, he met Canaanites, the people who were native to that region along the Mediterranean Sea. Most of the book of Genesis details how Abraham and his descendants had grievances with the Canaanites. Then, when Moses and the Israelites returned to the Promised Land after 400 years of slavery, the Israelites fought and made treaties with Canaanites in order to establish Israel as a Jewish nation. In general, Canaanites were usually polytheistic and had little regard for the God of Abraham. Jesus grew up in this culture where two books of his Bible are filled with stories about how Jews don't get along with Canaanites. As Jesus was learning to speak Hebrew, eat matzah during Passover, and making the pilgrimage to Jerusalem, he was also learning how Jews do not trust Canaanites. In other words, Jesus was learning how to be prejudiced against them. Prejudice is like these eclipse viewing glasses. I'm going to take them off because I cannot see my text. We are not born with these glasses on, but through our interactions with the world around us, we learn that it is okay to associate with some people, but not associate with other people. It is okay to go to some areas of town, but it's not okay to go to other areas of town. So by the time we reach elementary school age, we have put these glasses on so that all we can see is the light of the sun. We can see only what we're supposed to see, and everything else is dark. In the end, the culture around us tells us that some people are not as smart as others. Some people are more human than others, and some people are safer than others. This is a tough Bible story to interpret because it calls into question Jesus' omnipotence and his compassion for all people. If Jesus already knows that he is the Savior of the whole world, even Canaanites, why does he first ignore her? Then the disciples ask to dismiss her because she's so annoying. And then Jesus says he has not come for her, but rather the lost sheep of Israel, and then indirectly compares her to a yapping dog. Now, I love my dog because Sophie is our first child. Sophie and I share one thing in common. If there is food in the house that no one else will eat, it is offered to us. It's offered to me first, and then if I won't eat it, then Sophie will eat it. And if she doesn't eat it, it goes in the trash. Sophie and I are at the bottom of the beginning food chain. So no matter how much I love Sophie, I would never refer to anyone as a dog unless I was trying to insult them in some way. So this text is troubling for us because Jesus is insulting this woman who was desperate to have her daughter healed. This text shows the scene, like in a coat or a garment or a shirt. It's not all made of one cloth. Things are seen together, sewn together. This text shows the scene where Jesus the human meets Jesus the divine. Just like when Jesus is tempted in the desert with food, power, and prestige, Jesus is faced with the limits of the human imagination to see people different from him as human beings. I'll give you two ways to interpret this encounter. One, Jesus already has compassion for this woman before he even enters Tyre and Sidon, and he is modeling how a typical Jew would treat a Canaanite to teach his disciples a lesson about having compassion for others, regardless of whether they are Jew or Gentile. That's the first interpretation. Jesus was acting in order to teach the disciples a lesson about compassion. The second interpretation is a whole lot more interesting. When Jesus begins his ministry, he truly believes that he has come only for the lost sheep of Israel. That is, he is the savior of the world, yes, but he believes that his mission is only limited to Jewish people because he doesn't have time to save the whole world in just 3 years. This is illustrated in Jesus' commissioning of his disciples in Matthew 10. He gives them specific instructions. Don't go among the Gentiles into a Samaritan city. Go instead to the lost sheep, the people of Israel. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with skin diseases, and throw out demons. But don't do it among the Gentiles, just among the Jewish population. Since Jesus is limited to time and space, he limits his disciples' work only to Jewish communities. It is only through prayer and communion with God that the Holy Spirit broadens Jesus' horizons and the scope of ministry to include Samaritans and Gentiles. I think of this moment similar to Peter's vision in the book of Acts. In Acts 10, Peter has a heavenly vision where a sheet is lowered from heaven, and the sheet, like a tablecloth, is filled with all sorts of animals on it, including reptiles and birds. God says to Peter, "Dinner is served. Come and get it. Bon appetit." Of course, wild birds and reptiles are unclean in the eyes of Peter, so he objects, "For I have never eaten anything unclean in my life." God answers, "Don't call anything impure that God has made clean." After that vision, Peter goes to the house of Cornelius, a Roman Gentile soldier, which would be a ritually unclean act for any Jew. And then he baptizes Cornelius, a Roman soldier, and all his household. This event has been called the Pentecost for the Gentiles, where we learn that the saving acts of Jesus is not just for Jews, but for Gentiles, just like you and me as well. This is Jesus' Pentecost. Pentecost moment. Notice the similarities between the Acts passage and our Matthew passage. Jesus teaches the Pharisees in Matthew 15, verse 10, that one achieves holiness not through what you eat or how ceremoniously you wash your hands. I must say ceremoniously, because the Pharisees weren't worried about germs. But there was a prescribed way to wash your hands that has nothing to do with physical cleanliness. When I was at the Western Wall of Jerusalem, I saw how Hasidic Jews washed their hands before going to worship at the Western Wall. It's complicated. What Jesus was teaching was that impure thoughts, words, and actions are what makes a person unclean. Then Jesus is led by the Spirit to a region of Palestine that no Pharisee or even a Jewish rabbi like Jesus would ever go, the region of Tyre and Sidon. Anyone who's trying to remain spiritually clean would never enter this neighborhood. Jesus goes against his previous directives of not going to a Gentile town and dives right into the cesspool of sin. If you dive into a pool, you're going to get wet. And if you go to Tyre and Sidon, you're going to encounter unclean Canaanites. Like I said before, Jesus is there to teach the disciples a lesson about mercy and grace, or Jesus is learning that there is a wideness in God's mercy that is greater than his human mind can comprehend. It takes the pleading of a desperate woman to reveal to Jesus and to the disciples that God loves and cares for all people. And his healing and salvation power is not limited to a select few, but all who call Jesus Christ Lord. What happens in the encounter is that the relationship between Jesus and the woman goes from Jesus seeing her as an object to be disdained. It's being transformed into a human in need of grace. The woman becomes less of an object and more of a human being. This is what Jewish philosopher Martin Buber calls going from I, it, to I, thou. Thou is the old English way of saying you, like the old hymn, how great thou art. You could call that hymn, how great you are, but it just wouldn't sound right. So I call Martin Buber's relationship I, thou, because I, you just doesn't sound right. Anyway, the relationship between Jesus and the woman begins as I, it. That is, Jesus does not engage her as a human being, but rather an object. This is what Martin Buber says about I, it. The I is surrounded by a multitude of contents. The relationship has only a past and no present. In other words, insofar as a human being makes do with the things that he experiences and uses, he lives in the past, and his moment has no presence. He has nothing but objects, but objects consist of having been. The object has no duration of time, but is standing still, ceasing, breaking off, becoming rigid, standing out, the lack of relation, the lack of presence. In other words, Jesus is not seeing her as a human, but rather as an it, with a series of strikes against her, a woman, a Canaanite, living in Tyre and Sidon, the mother of a demon-possessed daughter. She is ritually unclean in so many ways. However, her persistence and her worship of him transforms the relationship from I, it, to I, thou. Her worship of Jesus reveals to him and reveals to the disciples and reveals to all of us that everyone, regardless of who we are, where we come from, what color our skin is, or what disease or mental illness or addiction we suffer from, everyone is worthy of receiving healing, grace, and mercy from God Almighty. This is when the eclipse glasses come off. The eclipse glasses of prejudice come off. And Jesus is able to see the Canaanite woman not as an object, but as a child of God. And what takes these glasses off is the power of love. The power of love lies in the relationship that God has with Jesus, that Jesus has with us, what God has with us, and the love that we have with one another. Buber says, love is a cosmic force. For those who stand in it and behold in it, men and women emerge from the entanglement in busyness. How often have you been entangled in busyness that you cannot see other people as human beings, but rather objects that are bothering us? Notice how the disciples are too entangled in busyness to hear the concerns of the Canaanite woman. Buber continues, through the power of love, the good and the clever and the foolish, the beautiful and the ugly, the one after another become actual and a thou for them. That is, liberated, emerging into a unique confrontation. And now one can act, help, heal, educate, rise, and redeem. Love is responsibility for an I and for a thou. In this consists what cannot consist in any feeling, the equality of all lovers, from the smallest to the greatest, from the blissfully secure, whose life is circumscribed by the love of one beloved human being, to him that has nailed his long life to the cross of the world, capable of what is immense and bold enough to risk it. A love for all humanity. Martin Buber sneaks the gospel of Jesus into his I-Thou philosophy. He says that Jesus was nailed to the cross by his I-Thou relationship love for all humanity. This kind of love is risky business. It could get yourself killed. But this is the love that Jesus is calling us to. And indeed, it is liberating. Jesus serves as his example and makes us capable of loving others who are different from us. Jesus demonstrates an I-it relationship with the Canaanite woman, first by ignoring her, then hearing the disciples complain, then explaining why he can't help her, then calling her something less than human, and then through worship, her humanity is realized and she is healed. Matthew cites Jesus' harsh words to remind us always to rejoice that God's love and promise for Israel first is fulfilled in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. To those of us who are Gentiles, who are like this woman, we have been adopted into the covenant tradition. To quote 1 Peter 2:10, we were once no people, We were once no people. We were once dogs. But now we are God's people. Once we had not received mercy, but now we have received God's mercy. We need never forget this. In this world which preaches hate against Jews, people of color, and anyone who is seen unclean by those who think they are special because they have fair skin, we must remember that we are all sinners, imperfect, and in need of God's grace. And we must never tire in giving thanks that in Jesus, God's promises stretch the length of all nations. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 389. Freely, freely. Let us stand as we sing. God's healing power. You were once blind, but now you can see. It is given to you through God's awesome love. Receive the love that God has given you and reach out to others with that same compassion. May God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.